radiological perspective in hemodialysis. And I selected perspectives from radiology to just to show you that the care of hemodialysis patient is multidisciplinary team. And this one of the secret of success of this center, that we have more teams gathered in one place. Professor Omar.
Thank you, Dr. Chairman. Good afternoon, everyone. Today we will discuss the role of radiology evaluation of hemodialysis patient. We will go very short tour about how to use the radiology in evaluation of hemodialysis. We will discuss three main points. First, how to diagnose patients with chronic renal failure. This first, how to confirm by radiology if it is approved for chronic renal failure. Second, how to assess the complication, renal and extra renal complication in patients with long-term hemodialysis. And the third, how to plan radiology, what's the role of radiology in hemodialysis and vascular access. The first problem we meet during evaluation of patients with chronic renal failure or patients with renal failure, especially those patients first seen with marked elevated serum creatinine, if it is acute or chronic. This is sometimes difficult question to answer, but in some cases we can diagnose a patient as chronic renal failure if there is radiological data or radiological findings that suggest or that keep it going chronic renal failure. We use ultrasound and Doppler ultrasound first. It is the initial examination done for the patient who is elevated serum creatinine presented for the first time with high serum creatinine. First, if we see if the kidney size is reduced and if there is a reduction cortical thickness, there is a regular contour, if there is parenchymal cyst or papillary calcification, we will suggest that this is a chronic renal impairment. Also, at Doppler ultrasound, if there is a reduced vascularity and if there is increase in resistive index, it will be highly suggestive of chronic renal impairment. Here, this is an ultrasound, and here we can find this is increased parenchymal echogenicity here. This is a kidney with irregular contour and increased parenchymal echogenicity. And loss of corticomedullary differentiation with a reduction of cortical thickness. And this is a papillary calcification. It is a case of chronic renal disease at ultrasound. Also at CT, we can get the same findings, but we have to reinforce the risk of radiation and the more cost than CT. But we can find this is a small sized kidney also with multiple papillary calcification and the regular renal contour. At contrast enhanced CT also, we can see this bilateral small kidneys with irregular contour and reduction or reduction of parenchymal enhancement in the case of renal impairment. MRI is a simple modality, but it's more expensive, but we can see without using contrast media, we can find this case with a deteriorated MRI coronal image, and this kidney with reduced parenchymal signal intensity. This is a case of parenchymal renal disease, and this is a dilated kinesis, and this is an irregular contour. Can ultrasound answer the question? In some cases, ultrasound can answer if it is acute or chronic, if the kidney is enlarged with prominent hypocoid pyramids and relative increase in parenchymal echogenicity, it's highly suggestive of acute parenchymal or acute kidney injury. While a small sized kidney with loss of corticomedullary differentiation, grade 3 echogenicity, with this small sized kidney, it is a case of chronic renal or chronic kidney disease. Also, can ultrasound differentiate between this case with acute obstruction to differentiate it, this case of obstruction with elevated serum creatinine from this case with polycystic kidney? This is an acute insult with a stone in the renal pelvis, and it can be treated surgically for drainage of the kidney, but it is a case of chronic kidney disease with polycystic kidney disease. So ultrasound can play an initial role for evaluation of patients of before hemodialysis to confirm that this is a chronic kidney disease. What is about the evaluation of patients on long-term dialysis to evaluate the complication after for the patients with long-term hemodialysis? We do ultrasound and brain X-ray as a routine evaluation for those patients. Also, we can do MRI and CT if there is a suspicious of malignancy or suspicious of acquired cystic kidney disease in patients with hemodialysis. The two main renal abnormalities diagnosed at ambitious with long term dialysis is the acquired cystic kidney disease and the second is the renal aneurysm. First, the acquired cystic kidney disease, it is the incidence of cystic kidney disease for renal cyst increase with the duration of dialysis. It, the incidence is about 10 to 10% in the first 3 years of hemodialysis, and it increases to be 50% after 5 years, and at 10 years it reaches about 90%. So with increased the duration of dialysis, we expect to get more cysts inside the kidney. Some of the cysts, the problem is that some of the cysts may be complicated with hemorrhage, and the patient may be presented with hematuria. Also, the incidence of transformation of renal cells to be renal cell carcinoma, the risk is increased in patients with hemodialysis to be about 3 to 6% than the normal patients. It's an example of CT without contrast. I can diagnose this patient with chronic renal impairment, and this is small size kidney with irregular contour, and this is multiple cysts acquired during the longer term hemodialysis. Also, in this case, also, this is a coronal CT, and this is a multiple cyst developed in the kidney during the course of hemodialysis. This is an MRI. MRI simply can diagnose this is a polycystic kidney disease or multiple cysts in the kidney, and this is a complicated cyst inside. This is a D2 weighted MRI, and this is a D1 weighted MRI. This is a multiple cyst replacing the same kidney, and this is a cyst here. It is a single cyst appears here at high signal intensity at D2 and of low signal intensity at D1. While this is a complicated cyst, I can see this cyst with low signal intensity at T2 and high signal intensity at T1. It is a hemorrhagic cyst. It is a complicated cyst during the course of hemodialysis. It is a hemorrhagic cyst and the big cyst. Some patients may present with hematuria. This is multiple cysts of high signal intensity at T1. It is a complicated. The cyst must be appear here at low signal intensity at here at the T1 weighted MRI and of high signal intensity at T2 weighted MRI. What is about the renal neoplasm? The renal neoplasm may be present with frequency to about 3 to 6 times more than the normal patient or regular patients in patients with hemodialysis. So the hemodialysis can expect that the risk of renal cell carcinoma increases by 3 to 6 times than the normal patients or than the usual patients. Periodic ultrasound control is recommended. It allows early diagnosis and early management of the patient. So it is recommended to do periodic periodic ultrasound for the patients on long-term hemodialysis. For how long I have to do this, what is the period I have to start? After 3 years, I have to start to do regular or routine ultrasound for those patients. Every 3 months, you have to do ultrasound as an investigation for those patients for the possibility of developing renal ultrasound. And I have to continue, even if the patient underwent transplantation, I have also to continue to follow up the native kidneys. What is about the renal cell carcinoma at imaging? This is the CT, as the same the renal cell carcinoma will be as the renal cell carcinoma in general, but I can see here this is a small kidney. It is a patient with chronic renal impairment, and this is a small kidney. This is a lesion here. This is before contrast injections. This is a lesion here, relatively isodense to the renal parenchyma, with mild contrast enhancement after contrast injection here at this axial and this sagittal images. This is the mass here enhancing here. The routine ultrasound allows early detection, and the early detection will improve the management and the patient's care. This is also an example of this is an enhancing lesion here at the left kidney. This is an axial CT. This is an enhancing lesion. This is a lesion here before contrast injection, and this is a lesion after contrast injection, and this is an enhancement by the lesion after contrast injection. And we can note here this is a vascular, also vascular complication associated with this lesion. In this patient on long term hemodialysis, this is a vascular calcification. This is the pleural thrombus inside the aorta. This is also one of the complications, extra-renal complications after long-term hemodialysis. What about the extra-renal complication? How can you use radiology diagnosis of extra-renal complications in the patients with long-term hemodialysis? We have many extra-renal complications, including musculoskeletal. fetal abnormalities, renal osteoporotic brown tumor, soft and tissue and vascular complication, and also cardiovascular complications. Musculoskeletal complication or musculoskeletal system infection usually due to secondary hyperparathyroidism. Secondary hyperparathyroidism is responsible of most skeletal abnormalities seen in patients with non-hemodialysis, including osteomalacia, osteoporosis, maybe sometimes amyloid deposition, and we have accelerated destructive spinal arthropathy in patients with chronic renal impairment. Usually we see general changes in patients in young age patients and patients with long-term hemodialysis. This, for example, this is an X-ray for the spine, and this is the spondylodegenerative changes, advanced spondylodegenerative changes in this patient with long-term hemodialysis. We can note this is sclerosed in the place with Roger Jersey vertebra. This is multiple osteophytes. This is erosion of the spine. And this is here inside the disc space, and this is calcification of intervertebral disc. Secondary to hyperparathyroidism, this is a secondary calcification also at the intervertebral disc. This is all due to secondary hyperparathyroidism and changes, spondylogenic changes in this spot. This is a case of osteomyelitis also in patients with long-term hemodialysis. This is a calcaneus of the foot. And we can note here, this is a destructive lesion with air inside. This is an aggressive infection, aggressive type of infection as a calcaneus with. This is a sinus formation and destruction of the bone. As we see here, this is the axillary, this is the images at sagittal, and this is the sinus tract and the extension of the infection into the soft adjacent soft tissue around the surrounding the bone. What about the term of renal osteodystrophy? It is a broad term used for to describe the bony changes in patients with chronic renal failure. It includes osteomalacia or rickets in patients with decreased calcium deposition in the bones, named either osteomalacia or rickets supporting the observation age. Also, if the secondary hyperparathyroidism was bone resorption, periosteal reaction, brown tumor, osteosclerosis, or osteoporosis. This is an example, this is a classic example, and this is a routine film for diagnosis of hyperparathyroidism and the erosion of the secondary metapharyngeal bone, the second, third, and fourth, fifth, second metapharyngeal bone. This is erosion of the lateral aspect. This is a bony erosion and bone resorption. This is here a magnified image, and this is the erosion. This is a sign of hyperparathyroidism with bone erosion here, and this is the bone resorption. Also, this is a CT, non-contrast CT, can easily diagnose the sclerosis for the portal. Bony sclerosis here at this area, bone here at both sides, and this is the bone resorption, this is the subcortical bone resorption, also secondary to osteoporotic, to secondary to hyperparathyroidism, and this is the bony changes that some relative osteosclerosis here, this is all secondary to hyperparathyroidism, and easily diagnosed at this non-contrast CT. What about the brown tumor? Brown tumor, it is a case of replacement of the normal bone marrow with vascularized fibrous tissue here. It is a result from parathyroid hormone stimulated osteoclastic activity. And it may be single or multiple lesion, and it can be found within bone and in the adjacent soft tissue. And it is sometimes problematic in its diagnosis, but as we can see here, this is a fibrous tissue. This replaces the bone marrow here, and there is some bone expansion, and there is cortical destruction in the left iliac bone. This is the scapula here, and this is the femoral head, and this is the expansile bone lesion here, and this is the iliac bone, and this is the sagittal image, and this is the expansile bone lesion and the cortical destruction also here. Also, this is vascular calcification, the study vascular calcification, and it decreases the elasticity of the blood vessel, and it leads to vascular ischemia, and it may lead to cardiovascular ischemic changes at the heart, and this is from the static vascular calcification and the blood vessel, as you see here, as this index. And also maybe sometimes in the static soft tissue calcification, as in this case of non-contrast CT of the abdomen, and this is the coronal image, and this is the vascular calcification here as the lateral aspect of the pelvic wall here as the right side pelvic wall with metastatic vascular calcification. What about this is the last? This what about the role of imaging or role of radiology in vascular mapping and to for creation of dialysis access? First, we have to be especially for radiologists who dealing with and do vascular mapping should be aware adequately for the anatomy, arterial and venous anatomy, and to do venous mapping and arterial evaluation of the blood vessel of the forearm and the arm of the forearm. This is the best site or the site of choice for creation of the fistula. What about the criteria of choice? What depends? First, we have to evaluate the artery at the suggested site of fistula. The artery caliber must be more than 2 millimeters. The artery between choice must be 2 millimeters at least at the Doppler ultrasound. And we have to measure the artery at the site of the expected fistula creation. So you have to measure the artery at the expected site. Or you have to take multiple measurements and leave the surgeon to select site. Also, we have to comment about calcification. In arterial evaluation, we have if there is atherosclerotic changes, if there is any calcification, intimate calcification, it should be mentioned at the record. Also, evaluation of the Doppler waves, we have to evaluate the upstroke of the systolic waves, and the diastolic flow must be evaluated at spectral Doppler. For selection of the vein must be not less than 2.5 millimeter. Must the diameter must be not less than 2.5 millimeter. We have to measure the caliber or the diameter of the vein at the forearm, especially at the spheric vein. And we have also to take multiple measures also to demand leave a surgeon for choice. We have to assess the compressibility. It's very important to assess the assist of the vein, it is compressible, completely compressible or not. It is an important point to be commenting about it in the report. If there is any occlusion, partial or complete thrombus must be evaluated at the radiology record. The size and the depth of the vein must be commented about it, about that. If there is any abnormality in the course of the vein, should be mentioned as a report, and if there is any collateral circulation, it may be suggested that there is an venous obstruction. The vein diameter should be measured at multiple sites. It should be for the mid and the cranial forearm and the antecubital fossa, and also for the mid and the cranial upper arm. This is an example of Doppler ultrasound for arterial evaluation. This is a normal arterial Doppler. This is we have to measure the diameter from intimate to intimate. This is the site of measurement, and it not should not less than 2 millimeters. It is important for creation of a acute fistula. The artery not less than 2 millimeters from intimate to intimate. And this is the color fluid. Must be homogeneous, no occlusion or no asymmetrical beliefs, no calcification here. And there is a homogeneous flow and no abnormality or the northern transmission as the fluid size. Also have to assess the spectral Doppler analysis. This is the upstroke, this is the triphasic wave here, this is the upstroke, and this is pulling down, and this is the self beam of the arterial fluid. So this is the normal spectral waveform and size the tracheal artery. This is the exact vein, and as we said, it's a vein diameter not less than 2.5 millimeter. This is diameter here is 5 millimeter. Optimum or this a way for the creation of the fistula. This is the xeric vein, and this is the vein here. And we have to assess the compressibility. I have to do compression upon the vein by the Doppler or by the probe. And I have to see here there is complete compression of the vein. The vein not completely compressed, and this is the case. And the elasticity of the vein is preserved, and no obstruction inside. How to evaluate the AV fistula? We have to do Doppler ultrasound for the AV fistula. We have to do transverse and longitudinal scan. We have to see the feeding artery and the draining vein. It should be evaluated. Also, to have to evaluate if there is associated complication, if there is stenosis, or there is abscess formation around the fistula, or there is very, very, very fistula, hematoma compressing. it's a fistula and the causing functional stenosis or stenosis or if there is associated seroma. What about the mature fistula? How to assess or how to judge that it's a mature fistula or a doppler aorta sound? The AVD diameter of the draining vein must be more than 4 millimeters. So the draining vein must be at least 4 millimeters. This is one of the criteria of mature fistula. The second is the distance of the fistula from the skin, not more than 5 millimeters. It should be 5 millimeters or less. This to judge that it's a mature adequate fistula. And third, you have to measure the volume. It must be at least 500 millimeters. All of these three criteria for to judge that this is a mature fistula and it should be done about two months after surgery or after creation of the fistula. This is the draining vein here is 6 millimeters, more than 4 millimeters, and the distance is less than 5 millimeters from the skin. So it is a mature fistula. It's a fistula evaluation of the fistula after. More than after 2 months of deviation of fistula, diameter more than 5 millimeter and the distance from the skin is less than 5 millimeter, it is a mature fistula. Also, this is another case of immature fistula. Here, the diameter is 3 millimeter. The diameter of the vein, the draining vein, is less than 3 millimeter and it is than 4 millimeter, and the distance from the skin is more than 5 millimeter. So, it is a mature fistula. Also, this is evaluation of the ultrasound. This is intimate thickening and this is stenosis. Most fistula stenosis, our stenosis of the vein. This is an intimate thickening here and here, and this is stenosis of the vein. Also, this is an obstruction. This is no flow inside. Here, we can see here, this is the flow inside the fistula here. This is the color flow inside the fistula, but no distant flow. No flow inside the draining vein here. It is also both. So most abdominal ultrasound. This is case of fistula with mixed. This is normal blood here, and this is the area echogenic here. It is a partial thrombus. This is a thrombus here. Combined more than half of the fistula, and this is an area of flow echogenic here. It is the patent. So it is a partial thrombus fistula here. Also, in some cases, maybe from repeated puncture, we can see this is sometimes pseudo-invasive from the repeated puncture. And this is a sinus that's called yang-yang side. This is a low and flow. This is a blood flowing in different planes. It is like Korean flag. It is a yang-yang side. Here, it is a sign characteristic for pseudo-invasive side. An example, sometimes the non-doppler ultrasound we use in evaluation of fistula, but also we can do venography here. This is a case of pseudoaneurysm also, in a case of arterial venous fistula from repeated puncture. This is a venography, we can use this is the pseudoaneurysm inside the fistula. Radiology not only for diagnosis, but we can do intervention. We can manage the complications of the fistula. Sometimes this is a case of stenosis of the draining vein of the fistula here. We can use this column of the caliber as we can compare this caliber with this caliber. This is the stenosis here, proximal part of the draining vein. And we do introduce a balloon catheter here inside the stenosis part here and do inflation to make dilatation of the draining vein or the draining vein of the fistula. And this is after, this is a control film after dilatation of this is stenosis vein here. This is again, it's a movement caliber. It is an outpatient procedure and can be done simply using radiology for dilatation of this. Lastly, nowadays we have this recommendation to do a central venous line or central venous access, which that is mostly used used frequently in dialysis patients, especially in initial dialysis session. We have to use ultrasound for insertion. This is a better thing to decrease complication. We have to insert this under ultrasound guide. That's and I think that there was a session yesterday about this. And we have then to use fluoroscopy to ensure that the depth of the castor is between the right atrium and the subarachnoid cava junction. When the castor are inserted without the benefit of fluoroscopy, precisely this method of we have it's better to do it ultrasound guided, then we have to use fluoroscopy to be sure that the كانت الأفضل في اسم الاس ان أليبو الزايد to avoid competition. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Professor, for this very interesting lecture. And it's open for questions. Any questions?